It was the reason I started translating it is because I've always been interested a lot in the faces. When I first started studying philosophy, I was, I'm ashamed to say that the speech of Lysias, I thought it a good speech. And I was impressed with it.
You're not alone.
Yeah, yeah. So did I.
And the speech of the non-lover, the speech of the guy who is supposed to have no passion and supposed to be the better type of person. But studying with Pierre, I found out that that's not the case. And I found out by studying that of course the passionate lover, the lover who's enraptured with divine madness is of course the best of all lovers. And in doing the translation, it came to me that I counted out the paragraphs, and that's what this is here. I counted out the paragraphs for the speech, and the way it's broken up is into 17 paragraphs. And I thought to myself, 17, curious. That's very curious. And I'll tell you why. In the Theaetetus, there's this section where, in paragraph 5 of the Theaetetus, where Theaetetus says this, it seems to me easy just now, O Socrates, as it comes to light in this way, and that you are probably asking just the kind of thing that also occurred to us lately, when your namesake, Socrates here, and I were talking together. What kind of thing was that, O Theaetetus? Socrates asks. And Theaetetus answers, Theodorus here was drawing some figures for us about the powers of square roots, showing that the squares containing 3 square feet and 5 square feet are not commensurable in length with the unit of a foot. And in this way, selecting each one in turn, up to the square containing 17 square feet. But at that point, for some reason, he stopped. Then such a thing occurred to us, that since the multitude of powers appeared to be infinite, to try to collect them under one name by which we could henceforth call all these powers. Seventeen, apparently, is a curious number because it brings it to a limit. It gave them a time to reflect. And the words that he uses, like it occurred to us at that moment, it brought them the whole idea of the nature of insight. And they had the insight that there was something going on here. And I thought to myself, you know what? Later on, he talks about how when somebody makes a speech, that it should be like a body. It should have a beginning, middle, and end. Head, a body, and feet. Mm-hmm. Well, the figure that I thought of was the divine figure, which is the circle. And of course, the square, which is another of the divine figures. And Carl Jung says that these two figures appear to people, that he's discovered the square and the circle as they're reaching a time when they become complete, when their constituent parts of the soul are becoming one and unified. And the Phaedrus is Socrates talking about our soul becoming singular, unified, with a singular purpose. So I adopted this figure. I figured that this figure is a noble figure, being that this same figure is the same figure that Socrates used in the Meno to, again, reach an intuitive insight with the slave boy. And this is the very square that he teaches, that he demonstrates, and brings the boy into a realization of that the answers were all within him. And he pulled out all those answers out of him. And thus, this noble figure is the one I chose. And it fit. It makes sense. There's 16 paragraphs that could fit inside, which makes the square, from 23 to 38. And then one to circumscribe it, which carries the whole intent and purpose of the whole speech. And that is broken, which is contains the four type of manias. The philosophical, the kingly, the prophetic, and divine musical inspiration. And that's like how I broke it up in such a way. Just recently, I had to, but anyway, before I go there, if you guys are interested in something that I also saw with the square of 16, that I put down in this translation that I did on the Theaetetus, you might be interested. And there's something about that square. It's even, it's very curious about the square of 16. Furthermore, showing the beauty of it. But just recently, I had to go to a class in Sacramento that I did not want to go to. And but anyway, I had to go, so I went. And on the last day there, I had an insight. And it came about because on the first day we got there, we were told that they gave us four cards, and here's the cards. The personality types, the four personality types. Mm-hmm. The innovator, and she gives his descriptions. The organizer, the description, the drives, the sources of stress. The liberator. Work style, drives, sources of stress. And then the facilitator, the personality, the work style, drives, sources of stress. So we were given those four choices. We were told which one we most resembled. They said that we would find a lot of qualities in all of them that really belong to us, but there was one that really stuck out for us, for each individual person. The one that stuck to me was the innovator. And everybody else, except me, was in one of the others. So I was there sticking up like a sore thumb. And one of the guys in the group that I was in didn't particularly like it, and he gave me a hard time the rest of the time, and not just nicely, you know, rubbing. He was not nice. So the last day that I was there, I was thinking about the personality types, and I had been reading Carl Jung, and he talked again about the squares, the circles, and such. And I had been translating all along when I was over there, the Phaedrus, and I was at the part where he talks about Zeus, Hera, Apollo, and Ares. And those are the only four he mentions. And I thought to myself, four. Could it fit into those types of manias? And I thought to myself, yeah, it does. And so anyway, I looked it up and thought about it, and it sure it really does. This is the first time that I made the connection that perhaps the four types of manias represented the four gods that he described: Zeus, Hera, Apollo, and Ares. And it made perfect sense. So that's how I put, why I put it like that. And another thing that I said, well, this is just to explain this front page. And if you look at the four types of mania, he describes the first type of mania of Zeus, the of course the best, and it's the kind of philosopher who is the kind of person that we should be. It's the kind of person that's described as the guardians, the ones that have that singularity of purpose, like they should all be. They all have a singular purpose. There's no split personality inside of them, like he describes at the very end of paragraph 38, where he describes Phaedrus as "But if in our former discourse," this is at the very end, "Phaedrus and I said anything harsh against thee, blame Lysias, the father of that speech. But turn him, just as his brother Polemarchus has been turned, toward philosophy, in order that his lover, Phaedrus, may no longer be split in two ways, as he is now, but may direct his life toward love in conjunction with philosophical discourses." This other person, on the other hand, he describes Zeus as a person who, his mania, that type of person, the person who follows Zeus, can take a greater burden, he describes him as. He can take a greater burden. On the other hand, Ares, he describes Ares that if he finds out that there's anything wrong with in his lover, if he thinks that he's been wronged in any way, he gets murderous, and he's ready to sacrifice himself and his beloved, because he can't carry a burden. Hera is described which I found so curious, not as queenly, but as kingly. Kingly. And then, of course, Apollo, prophecy. So, to me, by thinking about this, it makes sense that the four types that he describes are the four types of dispositions. Something else that I saw as I was translating this, I came to this one part. Which I thought very, very interesting. It's at paragraph 28. And in paragraph 28 he says, and so on the one hand, such is the life of the gods. But on the other hand, of the other lives of the other souls, on the one hand, that life which is best follows and resembles divinity. By super elevating the head of the charioteer into the outer place, and it is carried round together in that revolution, and being troubled by the horses, barely catches sight of the realities. But on the other hand, at other times it plunges down. Thus, by being overpowered by the horses, it sees some realities, but not others. And when I was doing that little part there, I started thinking about the way that the philosopher is described in the Symposium. How Socrates says that the nature of the philosopher is such that from his mother, he has certain qualities. And from his father, he has other qualities. And because of his father, and sometimes he's up at the he's at the heights. But because of his mother's nature, he loses that and he finds himself back down in the valleys. So, I was thinking about that when I was translating that, which reminded me of the ox herding picture, 3 and 4, where he talks about the ox, how at times he's very much like the philosopher. At times he's up in the mountains, and at other times he's down at the valleys. Maybe because he hasn't been tethered yet. But anyway, right after he says that, he says, then surely on the one hand, all the other souls follow after, yearning for the upper region. But on the other hand, they are unable to do so, being carried round underwater, trampling and casting spears at one another, the one being pierced quite through by the other. Therefore, the trouble in the contest for superiority and the sweat are extreme, and surely because of which many souls are maimed. This idea of underwater, I didn't see any of the other translators translate it, but kupo rukiai, that's exactly what it means. I'm wondering why. Why did he do that? Then I thought about Odysseus. Proclus talks about how cosmic dominion was given to Zeus, to Poseidon, and to Pluto. And this region here is where all this fighting is going on, under his dominion. Because they're underwater. This is his dominion, the dominion of water. And I remember this beautiful section. When, and this is the section when Odysseus is finally released from him. And when he's released, guess where he winds up? In the land of the shining ones, in the land of the luminous ones, the Phaeacians. And this is the beautiful story of when Odysseus is released from this dominion. Next, Calypso, the shining goddess, brought out the sailcloth to make the sails with, and he carefully worked these also and attached the straps and halyards and the sheets all in place aboard her, and then with levers worked her down to the bright salt water. It was the fourth day, and all this work was finished. Then on the fifth day, shining Calypso saw him off from the island, when she had bathed him and put fragrant clothing upon him. And the goddess put two skins aboard, one filled with dark wine, the other, the big one, filled with water, and put on provisions in a bag and stored there many good things to keep the man's strength up, and sent a following wind to carry him, warm and easy. Glorious Odysseus, happy with the wind, spread sails and taking his seat artfully, with a steering oar, he held her on her course. Nor did he sleep ever, descend on his eyelids, as he kept his eye on the Pleiades, and late setting Butes, and the bear, to whom men give also the name of the wagon, who turns about in a fixed place and looks at Orion. And she alone is never plunged in the wash of the ocean. For so Calypso, bride among goddesses, had told him to make his way over the sea, keeping the bear on his left hand. 17 days he sailed, making his way over the water, and on the 18th he showed the shadowy mountains of the Phaeacian land where it stood out nearest to him, and it looked like a shield lying on the misty face of the water. Coming back from the Ethiopians, the strong earth-shaker saw him from far on the mountains of the Solimoi. He was visible sailing over the sea. Poseidon was the more angered with him and shook his head and spoke to his own spirit. For shame, surely the gods have rashly changed their intentions about Odysseus while I was away in the Ethiopians' land. And he nears the Phaeacian country, where it is appointed that he shall escape his great trial of misery that is now his. But I think I shall give him a good full portion of trouble. He spoke and pulled the clouds together, in both hands gripping the trident and staggered the sea, and let loose all the storm blasts of all the winds together, and huddled under the cloud scuds, land alike in great water. Night sprang from heaven. East wind, south wind clashed together, and the bitter blown west wind. And the north wind, born in the bright air, rolled up a heavy sea. The knees of Odysseus gave way for fear, and the heart inside him, in deeply troubled, he spoke to his own great-hearted spirit. Ah, unhappy me, what in the long outcome will befall me? I fear the goddess might have spoken the truth in all ways, when she said that on the sea, and before I came to my country, I would go through hardships, and now all this is being accomplished. Such clouds are these with which Zeus is cramming the white sky and has staggered the sea, and storm blasts of wind from every direction are crowding in. My sheer destruction is certain. Three times and four times happy those Danaans who were died then in wide Troy land, bringing favor to the sons of Atreus. As I wish I too had died at that time and met my destiny. On one day when the greatest number of Trojans threw their bronze-headed weapons upon me, or the body of perished Achilles. And I would have my rights, and the Achaeans given me glory. Now it is by a dismal death that I must be taken. As he spoke so, a great wave drove down from above him with a horrible rush, and spanned the raft in a circle. And he was thrown clear far from the raft, and let the steering oar slip from his hands. A terrible gust of storm wind swirling together and blowing snapped the mast, tree off in the middle, and the sail and the upper deck were thrown far and fell in the water. He himself was stuck for a long time, nor was he able to come up quickly from under the great rush of water. For the clothing which divine Calypso had given weighted him down. At last he got to the surface and spat the bitter salt sea water that drained from his head, which was filled with it. But he did not forget about his wrath for all his trouble, but turned and swam back through the waves and laid hold of it, and huddled down in the middle of it, avoiding death sin. Then the waves tossed her about, the current now here and now there, as the north wind in autumn tumbles and tosses, thistle down along the plain and the bunches hold fast one another. So the winds tossed her on the great sea, now here, now there. And now it would be south wind and north that pushed her between them. And then again east wind and west would burst in and follow. The daughters of Cadmus, sweet stepping Ino, called Leucothea, saw him. She had once been one who spoke as a mortal, but now in the gulfs of the sea she holds degree as a goddess. She took pity on Odysseus as he drifted and suffered hardship, and likening herself to a winged gannet, she came up out of the water and perched on the raft and spoke a word to him. Poor man, why is Poseidon, the shaker of the earth, so bitterly cankered against you, to give you such a harvest of evils? And yet he will not do away with you for all his anger. But I do as I say, since you seem to me not lacking in good sense. Take off these clothes and leave the raft to drift at the wind's will, and then strike out and swim with your hands and make for a landfall on the Phaeacian country, where your escape is destined. And here, take this veil. It is immortal. And fasten it under your chest. And there is no need for you to die nor to suffer. And when with both your hands you have taken hold of the mainland, untie the veil and throw it out into the wine-blue water far from the land. And turn your face away as you do so. So spoke the goddess and handed him the veil. Then herself, in the likeness of a gannet, slipped back into the heaving sea, and the dark and tossing water closed above her. Now long-suffering, great Odysseus pondered two courses, and troubled he spoke then to his own great spirit. I mean, which of the immortals is weaving deception against me, and tells me to put off from the raft? But no, I will not do it yet, since I have seen with my own eyes that the shore, where she said I could escape, is still far from me. But here is what I will do, and this seems to me the best way. As long as the timbers hold together and the construction remains, I will stay with it and endure it through suffering, hardships, But once the healing sea has shaken my raft to pieces, then I will swim. There is nothing better that I can think of. Now, as he was pondering these ways in his heart and spirit, Poseidon, shaker of the earth, drove on a great wave that was terrible and rough, and it curled over and broke down upon him. And as when the wind blows hard on a dry pile of chaff and scatters it abroad in every direction, so the raft's long timbers were scattered. But now Odysseus sat astride on one beam, like a man riding on horseback, and stripped off the clothing which the divine Calypso had given him, and rapidly tied the veil of Inu around his chest, then threw himself headfirst in the water, and with his arms spread, stroked as hard as he could. The strong earth shaker saw him swimming, and shook his head and spoke to his own spirit. There, now, drift upon the open sea, suffering much trouble, until you come among certain people who are the gods' fosterlings. Even so, I hope you will not complain that I stinted your hardships. So he spoke, and laid the lash on his fair mane horses, and made his way to Aigai, where he has his fabulous palace. But now Athene, daughter of Zeus, planned what was to follow. She fastened down the courses of all the rest of the storm winds and told them all to go to sleep now and to give over, but stirred a hastening north wind and broke down the seas before him until Zeus sprung Odysseus, escaping death, and the spirits of death might join the company of o'er-loving Phaeacians. So he was free to go back. There's a lot of neat little things that I saw when I was translating. Like that thing about being underwater when they're fighting. But you have it? If anybody else wants a copy of it, I'd be more than happy to give you one. And I hope you enjoy it as much as I did. I sure clarified it for me. I'm not as confused as I used to be concerning this very beautiful dialogue. And what a wonderful speech.
It is. Thank you. Juan.
Could I see the...
Four Jungian types.
The lady said that they were ascribed to Hippocrates, that he came up with the four basic types of people.
Oh.
And they were called like Aries was called sanguine, which means bloodthirsty.
In
one of the meanings.
In the four types in that meeting, I didn't hear you say that there was a connection, but did you see any connection between the work you did with these four types and those that you mentioned in that?
You bet. Yeah, there was.
And that's what I didn't hear, so I was asking. And what an innovator was, what would be a facilitator?
Okay. Let me give you some of the things that they say about that.
Okay.
First of all, the innovator, but it says, work style, my natural style is analytical and systematic. I am a complex thinker, attracted to concepts and innovative solutions. I enjoy seeing the relationships between various ideas and drawing logical conclusions. I am a researcher and knowledge seeker. I bring vision to projects and will work at the long-term implications. I respect leaders for their competence. I thrive in stimulating environments, and I like knowing that there is room to grow. I enjoy the challenge of leading high-performing teams. I work best with little direction. I am an independent learner, always seeking new ways to solve problems. That's the innovator. Then the organizer. My natural style is orderly and efficient. I use logical analysis to solve problems and to make decisions. I like to organize and plan my projects or programs. I need a work environment that is steady and guided by well-constructed strategic plan. I am attracted to leaders who define clear objectives and deliver results. I am a direct leader who keeps the team on track. I perform best with direction and clear, precise instructions. I enjoy having opportunities to discuss what I am learning, allowing me to connect theory to practice. The liberator. If that doesn't say Apollo, I don't know what does. My natural style is action-oriented and adaptive. I enjoy challenges and I'm open to change. I seek adventures and new opportunities. I am a troubleshooter in my work and recreation. I like work that is exciting. I enjoy being outdoors and having a high degree of mobility in my work. I work best with leaders who give me choices and alternatives. I enjoy leading short-term projects. I am calm and productive in a crisis. I learn best through memorization and observation. I am resourceful, playful, spontaneous, immediate, physical, hands-on, concrete, direct, visual, open, detailed, oriented, observant, and in the moment. And finally, the facilitator.
Which one was that you just read?
The liberator. And for the innovator, my natural style is interpersonal and collaborative. I am attracted to a team-oriented democratic environment. I value authenticity, positive interaction, and harmony. I work best with leaders who communicate well and provide information, reinforcement. I care about employee morale and motivation. I am sensitive to the work atmosphere and feel drained by conflict. I am a motivational leader with vision and foresight. I like to coach and mentor people, helping them develop their potential. I need to feel that I am growing and that my job makes a difference. I am imaginative, reflective, empathetic, authentic, creative, intuitive, big picture oriented, flexible, idealistic, sensitive, complex, enthusiastic, caring, and sincere. Mm. And those are the four.
That's mm.
Thank you.
This last one was a facilitator.
Oh, that was the facilitator.
The last one, yeah.
So what do you think of this nice thing that Juan and Marie did? Mm-hmm. Right? What's the relationship between leaves? Now, row one, right? That's two and three. Right? Roman numeral two and three. Roman numeral, right? Two and three, et cetera. So we can just get to the text that Juana Marie gave us, and we can just take a look at section 24, right? So tell me, what's going on in 24 and 25?
You have 24 and 25.
Yeah, we don't have.
We don't have 24 and 25.
You have it.
You can read it to us, though.
Oh, here, we have this.
You have a hard copy.
We have this.
Lyndon can do it without the machine.
Okay.
That good.
That good, okay.
Let's hear it.
I presume a good number of you can get this idea. The paradigm. Right? Mm-hmm. Of the idea of the soul itself. Those are two interesting ideas. Now, as you know, just from this, would you not agree? I forget the name of the author.
Pluto? I believe so, yeah.
Would you agree there's a development in 24 to 25? Well, just in terms of the first is the immortality of the soul, and then the paradigm of the idea of the soul. So he first has to establish the soul, its immortality, then to talk about the paradigm. Now look here, does that mean, look here, could we say this? As an indication of development. Oh, wait a minute. Just to finish it. I forget, what comes after 25?
I think 26.
62, right.
62, probably.
After you get the paradigm of the idea of the soul, then you get its function, don't you? Power and function. So, would you go so far as to do this?
Sure.
Well,
moving along.
A lot of peculiarities to Plato. One is, when he's exploring any positive idea, he then will describe its negative. Agree? We're familiar with it. And And then he'll also talk about, when he talks about this, he will also, depending upon a couple of things, but essentially what he needs then is to say, there's something you can say about the negative that is also positive. You can also say something about the positive that is a weakness, that could be a weakness. So you have just architecture. So look here. Notice what Juan has done with Maria. They did this on top of that. See the diagram? Wouldn't it be interesting if we can take a look at 24 and 25 and see whether there's a positive and a negative?
Right.
And if so, then there are a couple here that are pure, aren't they? That is to say, there's no division. Well, see, suppose someone came along and said, probably really need 23, right?
So that would be pure.
Suppose someone said, you know what's curious about this? Is that, let us assume something. Let us assume you need
16
to make a set, let's call them, a set of ideas to make any idea clear. And they should be linked together. And when they're linked together, there should be some order to it. So if you have one idea, then you can say, if it takes exactly six things to attribute to this one idea, and if that is complete, then you don't need anything more. It's complete. Well, okay, go back. For each of these subjects, is it complete? Is it complete? In other words, what would happen if he's talking about the paradigm of the idea of the soul, and he needs two or three more paragraphs instead of the one he did, or the section that he did. Is it conceivable that each one of these ideas has a subset like this, and that and only that are needed to understand the idea? Nothing missing. Nothing superfluous. Now, you see, look here. See, just to play for one moment, okay? immortality of the soul herself. The immortality of the soul. Wait a minute. What would follow? Needs two blocks to deal with that subject. Mm-hmm. Or, there's a very important distinction between those two, and back it goes, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Now, if so, then we can say, can we not, that through the whole thing, there's a progression of ideas. And each one needs exactly the space that he gives to them, and it's completely adequate. And it's, in that sense, it's perfect. Then, you see, now, notice the diagram. With this inner square, could that be another dimension out here, like a cube, another dimension that you can, if so, look here, would you not agree, it looks like, if we can say this, that these four are not dealing with the negative side of the idea. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So you have eight, you have...
Or, what would follow if instead of that, you were so bold as to or make any other configuration within it, right? But it would have to represent something in the text, wouldn't it? Because if he is doing this in this way, that's a really very interesting kind of architectonic design to it. But wait a minute. Uh-uh. Maybe it's the other way around. Maybe if you understand ideas the way he understands ideas,
there's a design to them.
There's a natural architect design to a set of ideas, because this is a set of ideas.
Mm-hmm. Are you talking about the concept like fractals?
Sure.
Do you know what fractals are?
Fractals?
Mm-hmm. It's a mathematical concept that, you know, pervades nature.
How would it appear with this? Could you set one up?
Well,
it's a splendid idea.
The idea is that it needs to reflect in the material world,
uh-huh,
what is the divine principle.
Uh-huh.
Okay? So if you're talking here about a system that, you know, is reflective of the immortality of the soul, a fractal, you know, could be a concept that would relate to that idea.
And the idea must have a subset of other
ideas.
Right.
Fractals have subsets, and, you know,
yeah. Yeah.
They make up pictures in computers.
Yeah. So all I'm suggesting is that whatever figure you discover that can represent something, then you can sit back and talk about what are the implications of this, and then turn back on it to see whether or not there are even more distinctions that you can make. You have that's the original set. Notice this can go this way, this way, this way. Then there's an interrelationship between these, interrelationship between these, right? A unity of these, right? Transformation of the extremes into the mean position, right? So, like, a lot of things suggest themselves. Good heavens. Would you not agree we have to... Barbara suggested earlier that we could get someone to do this, to work it all out for us.
Yes, we did.
We would... forward a six-pack of beer to the person who'd be willing to do it.
Absolutely. Yeah. We'll take it out in the wedding society.
Yeah. And we'll take volunteers, Brad.
I don't drink beer.
We can make it your favorite tipple.
I knew something, someone would ruin it.
No, it's open, Pierre. Whatever she'd like to drink.
Yeah, that...
Evian.
All right, okay.
Yeah. When do you want me to do that?
How long have you been missing out?
For a while.
Okay. But I'm interested in this one, too, you see. See, it depends upon how much rigor, like, is 24, if you look at that in 24, is there a way of saying, see, if this is high and this is low, is there a way of looking at 24 and cutting in half? Does he approach it that way? Low, high, etc. You know, or should you consider this as a third dimension coming out of here, and therefore this splitting is not functional in respect to the ideas that we just described? But these are the primary ideas that one has been carefully noting, right? The four major ideas of madness, right? That's what this represents. So clearly, would you agree? Could you not, without ever doing any particularly challenging reflection, just look at this and it suggests certain things, doesn't it? Like, one thing would be, it looks like this and equally, a lot of things suggest themselves. So when you're lucky enough to get someone who does a model such as that, then we can play with it, can't we? But suppose for the moment it does work, right? That is, to something like this works. Could you go the next step and say, he didn't have to structure it this way, If you understand ideas, they naturally
have an architecture.
Have an archetype, architectural, architectonic feature to ideas themselves.
But so is that the reason in the Republic why he talks about the four kinds of geometry?
Yeah.
And why
could
we
be.
Have
possible.
Why we have the study of solids.
Especially solid geometry, which is no teachers of because it's not one of the most important study.
Because the solid deals with the third dimension.
A higher level of people. Okay, I just wanted to get Juan and Marie to.
One other thing that I noted on the paper here is this little note right here about the inner and the
come
outer.
Come on.
Well,
bring it with you. Oh. Or Crystal will keep it.
This, where I wrote this here about the inner and the outer.
Yeah.
The inner is 8 and the outer is also 8.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
At the very end of the Phaedrus, he has a prayer. And the prayer says that he prays
that
his inner and his outer are commensurate.
In harmony.
Oh, nice. That's
nice. We thank the
interesting.
Great work.
Yeah, thank you. All right.
Thank you, Juan. Very nice indeed.
We have volunteers, don't we, Barbara?
I believe so.
Shall we just vote on Rhonda doing it all?
Yeah.
Right.
Do we what all? Okay. Can we?